Hi, I'm Dominic De Franco. I'm supervised by Alison, Pease, and you're from the University of Dundee at the Centre for Argumentation as well. My PhD is going to be on personalising argumentation within persuasive technology. And the project I'm funded on is called the Council of Coaches. So, for this presentation, we're going to go brief over here what the Council of Coaches is. Then we're going to talk about the sort of exploratory studies I've done so far this year. So we've looked at a literature review, motivational interviewing recordings and research into motivational interviewing, health information behaviour study, which was a diary study looking at the sort of health information sources that people were using, and content work, so the papers that I've been working on so far. And then we'll talk about the future work, what I'm actually going to be doing in the next couple of years. So, Council of Coaches, we're looking to build a virtual e-health coaching platform that helps users manage their underlying health condition. So the three use cases we're looking at are chronic pain, age-related illnesses, and type 2 diabetes. And in Dundee, the case that we are focusing on is the multiparty argumentation and the dialogue. So not just between the user and the coaches, but between the coaches themselves. So looking at how the coaches can persuade and debate with each other. And so we're looking at that being a vicariously persuaded user rather than just using direct approach. So the exploratory work that we've done, I've done so far. So as Rory touched on, and as Martin touched on before this morning, and I disgracefully missed, so I apologize for that. We started by looking at Aristotle's topic, the methods of three modes of persuasion. So ethos, ethos, pathos, and logos. So I won't go too much into the detail with them, but I'm glad to talk about that. And then we built on that and looked at sort of Truman's model, Perelman, the new rhetoric, and what something I found really interesting was the theory of universal audience, something that will be really applicable for our application, where we're looking at how to personalise the argumentation for the audience, and in our scenario, the audience is going to be a single user. And also the computational methods, so from McDonald, and a lot of people were talking about computational methods today. And as well as the argumentation perspective, we looked at persuasive technology background in that. So things like the flawed behaviour model, where it's focusing on mostly subconscious methods of persuading people. So you're looking at, so it used to be a trigger, and he's changed it this year to a prompt. I haven't actually looked why he's done that, so I haven't done that. But I had a quick look this morning where I was just checking up on it, and I noticed, oh, in 2018, I've now changed the model. So it's about the underlying motivation of the user, the ability that they have, and we should have a prompt as well. And then that led to persuasive system design framework. So this is a big framework within the persuasive technology community. And it's basically based on the FOD model. And it's looking at taking all these aspects from the FOD model and how to design a behavior change support system. So it's looking at all the different methods. I've got some dialogue, the psychology behind it, aesthetics, and breaking it down so that you can have like a checklist which you can evaluate and assess the effectiveness of a behavior change support system. More recently, work's been done on something called the Transforming Social Tech Design Model. And while the FOG model was looking at the subconscious trying people to motivate them. So there's no motivation, there's no looking at belief change, it's just about subconscious behavior change. Whereas TSD model was taking that and looking at how do you actually transform it, how do you make these changes permanent? And to do that, it's looking at the different experiences they've had, the environment, and one of the things is always the belief change, and they're looking at the dialogue. So how do the underlying dialogue affect the belief changes and from there on the behavior change as well? So in order to make the changes transformations, i.e. permanent, we're looking at how to affect the belief changes. So we'll briefly talk what the GP said was it. So you went to your GP, you went to the doctor, and you said, look, that's what's wrong with me, they told you, and then that was it. So it's now it's all patient focused, so it's the patient and the doctor consensually reaching a decision and interest of the patient, and this is what shared decision making. There's been a lot of work in different argumentation schemes within shared decision making, and some of these will be quite useful for us. So when we're looking at the argumentation schemes, there's quite a lot of research into what are the most persuasive, and the two that came to mind again and again in the papers were by example and by authority. And so by authority, in our case, is usually a medical practitioner or a professional design coach or something like that. And the example is something that we'll be looking at later on in stories. So the motivational interview, this is a type of coaching where the decision is shared. So it's based on shared decision making. And essentially, the patient, you're trying to understand the underlying motivations of the patient in order to best to approach that will suit them, will persuade them. So it's about consensus, it's not about judgment. And to better understand this, we did sessions where we had an actor doing a patient and we had different professionals doing it one-on-one and as a panel to replicate what it might look like from our virtual application in the future. From there we had the guy that was the actual motivational interviewing expert. It turned out that he was running a course on motivational interviewing and things like one Africa. So we went on that NHS course on motivational interviewing. And used a lot of those techniques for the paper that we were involved in. The other exploratory study was the health information behaviour study. So this is just recently finished. And this was where we recruited a dozen people with, in Dundee, we were focusing on the type 2 diabetes category. So they had type 2 diabetes, age range roughly between about 50 and 70, and they were diagnosed roughly between 6 months, I think it was earliest, in like 10 years. And we were looking to see what type of information they, so in our case, we were looking at what information they find most persuasive, so the kind of sources, kind of ethos behind these sources, why they find them persuasive, what actions they took. And this again led on to a common paper. So, what content work have we actually produced? So, the first thing we did was, in order to measure, to find out if something's persuasive, you need to be able to measure it. You need to be able to evaluate it. So there's a number of ways where the persuasive technology community have done this. Most of them are based on the persuasive design network. So on the right, left there, is the PPQ. So this is based on the persuasive design, and you can see the different categories. And so these are just like a questionnaire that you would ask the user. So it's like the perceived persuasiveness. So we adapted this for a further paper when we were talking about films. And I'll talk about that briefly in a minute. Another way of measuring it is ranking tabs. So this is a desert island kind of thing where the famous example is you would, if you're from a desert island, what items would you bring with you? So you would ask the person to rank the items, you'd then give them a persuasive interaction. And then after that, you would rank, ask them to rank again, and you'd measure the difference, and that would be able to get a persuasion measure from that. Like I said before, BCSS is, and in persuasive technology, a lot of it is subconscious. So it's about how do you incite people to behavior change, rather than how do you get them to change their underlying beliefs. And so this example here is where you see in, they're trying to get healthier snacks in instead of sweeties in supermarkets, and you find that just a simple thing like that like influenced people in eating healthier. So it wasn't changing any of the beliefs. A lot of them didn't realize it was happening, but when they measured it, they found out that people were eating healthier and choosing healthier snacks just because they were in the vicinity of the checkout. So what we want to try to do is to see how to measure this is. One of the big kind of drawbacks of persuasive technology is that they set the experiment, and these experiments are quite expensive to run, they need a lot of users, and a lot of technology involved. long time. And then at the end of it, then you get your findings, and then you can use that to change the experiment. So you need a number of experiments, a number of user tests and evaluations to actually find out what's going on. So what we were looking at is, how do we do this during the experiment? So how do we measure what do we measure, and how do we measure it throughout the whole experiment, and how do we change it, the technology, the application throughout it, or the persuasive scenario, to make it more persuasive throughout the experiment, to kind of increase the cycle, to speed it up. And so this was the preliminary evaluation matrix that we did. So this was for a paper in the Persuasive Technology Conference in April. And what we split into was the type of persuasion, so we're looking at what kind of schemes would be involved in it, the mode, so ethos, pathos, logos, and what kind of approach would be. So would it be incremental, as in a bit by bit you're building up the argument, or would you hit them with the main point straight away? Talk about the persuading themselves, so what is their initial position, what are their initial beliefs? And then belief entrenched, or how entrenched is the beliefs? How are these beliefs linked to other beliefs? Is it going to be harder to change their minds? Is it going to be easier to persuade them? And how persuadable they are, so different people are more easily persuaded than others. And again, when we talk about evaluation, we're looking at different methods, qualitative and quantitative methods, when it's performed, so you're performing it all the time, like what we're looking to turn to a framework to do, or is it just at the end of the experiment? And who performs it? So is it going to be done manually? Is it going to be done computationally? This was a paper that we has just been accepted for the IEA conference, and this was where we had looking for the effects of multiple agents. Our system has one of the unique things about the approach platform is that we multiple agents rather than just one-on-one. And we were looking at how the effects of multiple agents on user precision was, and a number of other things as well. So the number of, and so when we were talking about multiple agents, there's only two in this case. So we have the number of agents, we have the gender of the agents, the state of the agents, so we're talking about whether it's a peer or authority figure. So we're talking about more, like, do they build up the ethos of the character? Are they more stern? And a peer, they were like younger, they were more friendly, the dialogue was a lot looser, more like slang was used, it was more friendly. The focus of the agent, so in the case of multiple coaches, were they both trying to persuade the user, or in the case of a peer's persuasion, were they acting out a persuasive dialogue in front of the user and trying to persuade them that way? These were the different conditions that we had. So we had the four cases for the single agents. We had the female authority, male authority, female peer, and male peer. We had for the multiple agents, so we were in the vicarious persuasion and user directed. So that was, so we had the female authority persuades the male authority, so and so. And then for multiple agents, it was female agents, male agents. So because we didn't want to focus completely on gender, in the multiple cases, it was always a male or a female, rather than two males or three females. So we originally did this experiment on cornflour, and we had a bit of a problem. We had to redo it again for the mailing list. And one of the things they found the first time was that females were not seen as credible for our expert as males, even if they're saying exactly the same thing. And as I was on the male program on this paper with my lovely major, that was a little bit of an awkward discussion at the end of that. But at the end of when we did more testing, that was after 100, so we did about another 200 user bases, and the gender wasn't effective in that at all. So it was just the same for whether it was a male or a female. But what you notice is that overall, the multiple agents were much more persuasive and credible than just a single agent. And also interesting for us, the vicarious was seen as more persuasive as well. Although, so to do the, we tested for the perceived persuasiveness, and we also did the ranking task to see what the actual level of persuasion was. And it turned out that the people, although they thought that the user-directed approach was more persuasive, the actual result showed that the vicarious was more persuasive. So that was one of the kind of interesting things in the paper. We also took the multi-party dialoguing amongst the coaches, they can query each other's goals. They can, the patient takes ownership of the goal, and the patient can propose a goal. And so this is quite novel within dialogue games and shared decision making scenarios. So, future work. So I've just come to the end of my first year, and I should be writing my transfer report. I am writing my transfer report, deciding what I'm going to be focusing on for the next 2 years of my studies. So what I'd like to do is, I mentioned earlier about examples being one of the most persuasive types of argumentation schemes. We'd like to, I'm looking to make a story generator. So what to try to, and the idea is that stories are one of the best ways to persuade people subconsciously, because they don't realize that they're being persuaded through, it's not like a direct approach, so it's more indirect. And to do this, we need to gather the initial information. So we have the dialogue between the users, and we have the argumentation schemes in the AFPB that go up from the dialogue framework. So we're looking at how do we look at that to see what type of story would be suitable for this person to persuade them. So obviously we're looking at when is an argument appropriate, what story to use, how do we adapt the story to the user themselves, how do we measure its effectiveness, how to generate these stories, and how to actually build it, computations, what technologies we use. So I had a recent conversation with Pablo Gervais in Madrid. And he's an expert on story generation. He's saying that this is quite a novel approach. They usually spend their time on generating stories and actually what to do with stories themselves. So